Hello and welcome to video number 4 of the free online version of the Fusion Research Lecture. We are in chapter 1 and you might remember in the last video we mostly talked about the nuclear fusion process itself, and today we will focus about a few key parameters important for in fusion research. So some key parameters will be our topic today. From last video, you might remember that the DT fusion reaction was the most attractive one to be pursued on Earth. So that is definitely the candidate for our fusion reactors. And DT fuses into a helium nucleus with 3.52 MeV and a neutron with 14.06 mega electron volt. And as I said last time, only the energy of the alpha particle can be further used for heating, because only this is confined in the magnetic cage. So only 20% of the energy released in the fusion process is left for further heating. And this means a good confinement is required to achieving a self-sustained fusion reaction, a fusion reaction which is sustained by the heating of the fusion reaction itself. So this means good confinement is required for a self-sustained fusion reaction. And a quantity to measure that is the energy confinement time. So that is the energy confinement time. Energy confinement time. This is defined as the plasma energy content divided by the heating power. So the energy confinement time, tau E, is W over P, where W is the plasma energy content, the denominator, plasma energy content, the denominator, and in the denominator we have P, the applied heating power. Applied heating power. And the plasma energy content is the sum of the energy of the electron and the ions. So we have the plasma energy content being the sum of the electron's energy and the ion's energy. And here we take the kinetic energy, so that is 3/2 and then electron density times electron temperature. And as you might know, this is from averaging over a Maxwellian. So this is from average over a Maxwellian or a Maxwell-Boltzmann distribution. And we not only have the electrons, but also the ions. And we write it like this here. And we have to, since we're interested in the whole energy content, we have to take the integral over the whole plasma volume. This allows us then to calculate the energy content of the plasma. Now let's have a look at an example. So let's consider the energy content of 50-50 deuterium tritium plasma, because that is what we would like to have in our fusion reactor. That at first, since we are in plasma physics, you know we have quasi-neutrality, meaning that the ion density is equal to the electron density, and we just abbreviate that with N. Then we assume that we have no impurities, meaning that the ion density is given as just the sum of the deuterium density and the tritium density. Then, as we have written down above there, we have a 50-50 DT mix or mixture, which means that the deuterium density is equal to the tritium density, and that would correspond in our notation here to n over 2, to n half. Furthermore, we have a typical fusion plasma, which has densities on the order of 10 to the 20 particles per cubic meter. That means there is a strong energetic coupling between electron and ion, so there's a lot of collisions going on. Energetic coupling. And that takes care that the energy of the electron and the ions, the temperature is very similar usually. So the electron and the ion's temperature can be assumed to be similar, and we abbreviate that with a capital T. Now this allows us to write the energy content of a fusion plasma. We again have the volume integral, and then it's 3 half Ne, the electron part, the ion part. And since, as we have written it above there, the electron and ion density is the same, the electron and ion temperature can be assumed to be very similar. This can be just written as 3 times Nt dV. And this allows us to give an approximation for the energy content of a typical fusion plasma being approximately equal to 3 times the volume times n bar and t bar. And what are n bar and t bar? These are volume averaged quantities. So n bar, t bar, these are volume averages of n and t. Okay, this is a formula to get an estimation, approximation of the energy content of a typical fusion plasma, of a typical DT fusion plasma. Now let's go one step further and look at the power balance. The power balance. Now, a power balance, let's assume we have somehow a plasma. This is supposed to be some kind of plasma, and then we have some this plasma has some energy content W. It has some heating power going into it, some auxiliary heating. So we have some heating going in, and we have some losses P. We use an L for that, L like losses. And in steady state, we assume that losses are the same as heating. Yeah, what goes in must go out, basically. So this is how steady state is then defined. In steady state or equilibrium, losses are equal to the heating power. And this means that PL can be defined, or is defined, as the energy content and then over the confinement time, and that this is supposed to be the same as the heating. So here we have an expression for the losses. And now let's have a look at the power input. So what about the power input? So first of all, we have the external heating power, external heating P, and then auxiliary, as I have drawn it in the sketch over there. But then we also have the alpha particle heating, the alpha particle heating P alpha, which I have not drawn here yet. So let's draw another arrow pointing inwards. This is P alpha, and this can be written as the density of deuterium times the density of tritium, and we knew that this is n over 2, And since we have both of them, it's n over 2 squared. Well, as I said, n deuterium is equal to n tritium, and that is equal to n over 2 and half, as we had it written on the last slide. So n over 2 squared, and then times the fusion reactivity, which we had introduced in the last video, the fusion reactivity times the energy of the alpha particles. And then we are again have to take the integral over the whole volume. Now, this here has the unit, so the first term, sorry, it has a unit of meter to the minus 6, and the second one to meter squared meter over second. So overall, this is something like reactions per volume per time. So this is something like reactions per volume and per time. Well, and E alpha is, of course, the energy of the alpha particle, so 3.52 MeV. Okay, now we have the power of the alpha particles here serving as a heating power, auxiliary heating, and the losses. Now let's have a look at a power balance. So, because the power balance allows us to define or derive conditions for a self-sustained plasma. This is what we're interested in. So conditions for a self-sustained plasma from a power balance. Let's mark, oops, there is a C missing, I guess. So we have here the important expressions here are self-sustained plasma and power balance. Now, a self-sustained plasma is usually defined by the fact that the alpha heating power exceeds the power by the losses, yeah, so that there is more power provided by the alpha heating than is transported out of the plasma by losses. And this point is often defined as ignition, or well, to be ignition, and to be more precise, often you read that ignition refers to the point where the losses are just the same as the heating power by the alpha particles, because that in principle implies that you can turn off your auxiliary heating power and your plasma is kept burning. Okay. So, since we had on the previous slide the heating power by the alpha particles, we can now write this down. Integral over the volume, n squared over 4, then the fusion reactivity, then the alpha particle energy, and that this is supposed to be larger than 1 over tau e, then the energy content of the plasma, for which we had also on the I think it was two slides ago, yes, the expression 3 times, and then here the kinetic energy, n times t, so density times temperature. And now we can get rid of the volume here, and we can in addition take the volume average quantities, so take the average quantities n bar and t bar, and then we end up with a condition, which reads n bar squared over 4 times the fusion reactivity times the energy of the alpha particles, and that this has to be larger than 3 volume average density times volume average temperature divided by the energy confinement time. Okay, this is the first expression for a power balance which we have to fulfill to achieve a self-sustained plasma. Now, there's one, so far we have only included basically losses due to transport. So the losses so far here are just due to transport, because here we have the profiles of density and temperature going into it. But there are also, however, radiative losses, which we have to mention. So there are also radiative losses, and most importantly of those are, at our parameter range, the losses due to Bremsstrahlung. So Bremsstrahlung is or can be an important loss mechanism. We have to be aware of it. What is losses or what are losses via Bremsstrahlung? Well, if we have an electron, we have an electron flying around and encountering an ion, then it is decelerated in the electric field or by the electric field of the ion. And this deceleration process leads to an emission of a gamma quant or electromagnetic radiation. And if the electron had the energy E1 before encountering the ion and then being decelerated by it, having the energy E2 afterwards, then the energy of the gamma quant of the electromagnetic radiation corresponds to the different of those two quantities, so E1 minus E2. Okay, so Bremsstrahlung is basically the d, oh, sorry, this looks a bit weird, the deceleration, or it's due to the deceleration of charged particles in other charges field, in the electric field of another charge. And this leads to the emission of electromagnetic radiation. And typically, this is in the X-ray regime, and also typically, these are electrons encountering a nucleus. And this happens indeed quite often in our plasma, since we have a lot of electrons and ions there. In fusion plasmas, typically the degree of ionization is one, so there are a lot of these interactions going on. So in a plasma or in general, these are losses via, we can call them electron-ion collisions. So these are Coulomb collisions, and they become non-negligible if the electron and ion, if the temperature of those two particles exceeds 10 kilo electron volt, yeah, then we can no longer just neglect the losses via Bremsstrahlung. An expression for the Bremsstrahlung losses are given by the equation CBr, so some constant, times the effective charge number, times density squared and temperature square root. So first of all, let's briefly write down the constant CBr. This is 1.04 times 10 to the minus 19. And then we have meter cubed electron volt over second. And Z effective here is the effective charge number. So that is the effective charge, important quantity. And the effective charge is defined as the sum over all ions in the plasma, so over all charged particles, and then the number density, and then the charge number squared, and that is important, the charge number squared, then over the electron density. So Bremsstrahlung losses in a plasma not only occur at hydrogen nuclei, but also at impurities, and by also I mean even more at impurities, because due to the squared dependence of the charge number, this can be a significant loss mechanism. So Bremsstrahlung losses not only at hydrogen, more importantly, let's say, at impurities. Oops, at impurities. And only for hydrogen, the charge number is equal to 1. For impurities, the charge number, for all impurities, the charge number is larger than 1. And also for helium, so also for the helium ash, the charge number is larger than 1. And as I said, due to the squared dependence, if we have impurities there, Bremsstrahlung losses can be a significant loss channel in our plasma. This is why we have to keep impurities at the minimum level. Okay, in this video, we talked about a few important parameters. This was the energy confinement time, being defined as the ratio of plasma energy content by applied heating power. We talked about the plasma energy content being the sum of the electron and ions kinetic energy. We started with a power balance and showed how conditions for a safe sustained plasma is basically defined by a power balance. And then just on this very last slide, we talked about radiative losses and that radiative losses are mostly due to Bremsstrahlung in our plasmas and that the effective charge number plays an important role here. And that the Bremsstrahlung losses have a squared dependence on the charge number. And this basically says that we have to keep impurities at a minimum level, otherwise losses via Bremsstrahlung might be a real problem. Okay, that's it for the fourth video. And I hope to see you in the next video where we will derive and define further key parameters in fusion research.